Okay, it's 6:30 p.m. Let's get started. Welcome to the webinar, Japan's Climate Challenge and What That Means to the World. I'm Kazu Ichijo, Dean at Hitotsubashi ICS. This webinar is hosted by Hitotsubashi ICS. Hitotsubashi ICS is a global B school. We are number one according to the QS ranking here in Japan as a global MBA. So therefore, our mission is developing global leaders who can be who can work as excellent problem solvers. So therefore, we've been watching the global issues and doing research and organize a forum like this. The apparently the climate challenge, global warming is one of the biggest of the global issues. And the, as you know, the yesterday Dr. Manabe got the Nobel Prize because of his intensive research for the global warming, pioneering research for the global warming. So therefore, this webinar is held at the right moment. I hope that this webinar will be a big step in moving ahead to overcome the challenge of Japan's climate challenge, and so that we can make a big impact on the world. Okay. So therefore, let me pass the baton to Peter. Peter, time is yours. Thank you.
I'm sorry, I was, I think I was not muted there. Can everyone hear okay? Yumiko, are we okay?
Yes, we okay. Can hear you. Thank you.
Wonderful. Okay, just getting the tech worked out there. I'm so glad to be representing the Wall Street Journal today and to have this opportunity to work with the people at Hitotsubashi University in bringing this webinar on Japan's climate challenge. And we have four of the best people I can think of to talk about these issues today. I'll just introduce them very briefly and then move on to the discussion. We have Mr. Masakazu Toyoda, who is the chairman and CEO of the Japan Economic Foundation. And for more than a decade, he was CEO of the Institute of Energy Economics Japan, IEEJ, which is a well-known name to anyone who studies energy, really an authoritative and respected source of energy information. And that followed along a career at the Ministry of Economy, Trade, and Industry, or back to the days when it was known as MITI, M-I-T-I. Another panelist is Emi Osono. Professor Osono is a professor at the Hitotsubashi ICS, which stands for a School of International Corporate Strategy. And she's also told me that she is a committee member on one of the groups advising METI, the ministry we just heard about, on its Green Innovation Fund. So we'll hear a lot more from her. Professor Takashi Nawa of the also of Hitotsubashi ICS has a very distinguished career at places like Mitsubishi Corp, McKinsey, and he's a board member, an outside board member at several of Japan's top corporations, and of course, how companies are dealing with climate change and how they are addressing that challenge will be an important topic tonight. And finally, let me introduce my colleague of many years at the Wall Street Journal, Fred Dvorak. She's joining us today from the U.S. She's in the U.S. at the moment. It's quite an early hour there, as you can see from the from the window behind her. Fred has been our senior Asia correspondent and reported throughout Asia, including India, Japan, and elsewhere on energy challenges, solar power, hydrogen, ammonia, and those types of issues. And so she brings a reporter's perspective to climate change and energy policy. So I wanted to start off by asking everyone to introduce themselves. I'm sure I left out some key facts about everyone. Introduce themselves with perhaps a personal anecdote of how you're affected by these issues. I know working from home for the last year and a half, I've seen our electricity bills go up, and I realize how much it costs to keep this room that I'm in right now at home cool in the summer and hot in the winter. Becoming more aware just from those bills myself, which normally the company pays, about energy policy and conservation, which is a key part of this. So maybe I'll start with you, Toyoda-san. I understand you recently acquired an electric vehicle, an EV. And I wonder if you could talk about that a little bit and also introduce yourself.
Well, Randall-san, thank you very much for introducing me. Good evening. My name is Kazu Toyoda. Thank you, Wall Street Journal and Hitotsubashi University for inviting me at this very stimulating panel. I had been CEO and chairman at IEJ, Institute of Energy Economics, for 11 years, but I became now, 3 months ago, I became a special advisor. Perhaps it's time for me to change my position. Thank you very much, Randall-san. I think I try to do a lot of things in order to address climate change, but most of them are costly. And I try to conserve energy, but insulation material is not cheap. And so my adventure is that I changed my vehicle from hybrid to electric vehicle. This is adventure for me. But I found a lot of advantages and also disadvantage, I have to say. Advantage, yes, it's clean and quiet and comfortable for driving. But disadvantage, perhaps everybody thinks driving range is limited. But now I think I understand that and I don't drive too far and so this is good enough. But I sometimes go to the countryside and I found this summer on vacation, I went to Kamakura, Inoshima, but I was a little bit nervous about whether charging station is there. And I think the charging station is there, but whether or not the fast charging equipment is available, I think still it's not sufficient. And I understand that this is the issue of infrastructure. Clearly, companies or station need to make efforts, but perhaps at the start, I think the government should spend sufficient expenditure for improving this infrastructure. I understand in many countries, in the United States, in Europe, the government is trying to improve charging stations, increase the number of charging stations. In Japan, yes, they are trying to do that, but at this moment, the government, the Japanese government, is focusing on more on R&D rather than improving infrastructure. And so I hope the new government is trying to spend sufficient expenditure for addressing climate change, including improving the infrastructure, charging station for electric vehicle. Usual charging station or charging equipment, it takes 6 hours, 7 hours. And so we have to find a faster charging, which takes only 30 minutes or less than that. And so the number of stations with fast charging equipment is not sufficient. I hope the new government is trying to improve that situation. Perhaps I had to step here. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Yes. 7 hours is an awfully long time to wait when you want to get onto your next stop. Osono-san, I wonder if you could talk about how you personally have felt this these climate challenges in your own life.
Yes, very hot summer. And I prepare a packed lunch, bento, for our son every day. And because summer is so hot, I worry the bento go rotten. So, but the good news is that we can put the frozen food without defrosting, so that when our son eat lunch at school, it might be okay. But yeah, very, very hot summer. It's almost also concerned about our mother in her 90s, you know. It's very tough on elderly people.
Right, it seems, you know, just even in the last 30 years since I first moved to Japan, it seems like it's getting hotter. How about you, Nao-san? How have you been affected?
All right. Nice web meeting you guys. And also, Toyoda-san, I think I met you 2 decades ago when you were the kind of a big boss in MITI. And I was just a young partner in McKinsey at that time. And nice meeting you again.
Nice meeting you.
Yes. Since then, I moved to Hitotsubashi, and then I spent 1/3 of my time in Tokyo, 1/3 in Hakone, where my house is located, and 1/3 is in Kyoto. My background is Kyoto, actually. It's a beautiful Zen garden behind me. And as Peter-san talked about, I am serving as a board member of several companies, and one of them was Denso. You may know Denso, which is a first tier company of Toyota Group. And when I was there, I was lucky enough to drive a Mirai. Do you know Mirai, which is a fuel cell vehicle? And it went not so bad compared with Tesla, you know, Toyota's car. But and it went very smooth and very kind of good ride. But I was warned by my colleagues of Denso not to go too far away, because there was only one service station which can charge hydrogen at the time nearby Nagoya area. So I was very unlucky, unluckier than Toyoda-san. I couldn't move around. So as Toyoda-san mentioned, infrastructure is the name of the game. And if we talk about hydrogen life, which I think Toyota-san would talk about later, but we need to really have this kind of infrastructure deployed in Japan, and I hope all over the world as well. That's my kind of bit unlucky experience with this fuel cell vehicle.
Right. Fred, you've written a little bit about hydrogen, and we will discuss that further, but And you've also had the chance to travel internationally in the last couple of weeks, which many of us have not for a long time. Tell us about some of your experiences personally with climate change and energy change.
Yeah. Okay.
I was going to pass the baton to Fred.
Hey. Pleasure. Yeah, go ahead, pleasure being on this panel. And yes, I have written about hydrogen, partly in thanks to Toyoda-san, who brought it up when I did an interview with him earlier this year. My personal anecdote: I've moved a lot in my life, and especially during the last 10 years or so. I've come from the US to Canada, to Japan, to Hong Kong, to Japan, and soon back to the US. And I noticed that I'm now thinking about where I move in a different way. I used to think about, even in a city where I would like to live, someplace with nice views or sunlight, et cetera. Now I'm thinking about natural disasters and how I'm going to have to watch out for flooding. So first, I'm going to have to look for, you know, places that are not going to flood. Or if it's on the West Coast, maybe I don't want to move to the West Coast of the U.S. because of all the fires. And I used to love San Francisco and think that I would love to live in that area. But I know it's gotten very smoky from friends there in recent years. And that area has gotten quite dangerous. And so I think about places and I think about where I want to live and in a very different way in the last few years than I have before.
Right. It's interesting. Each region has its own sort of natural disasters and sort of biblical plagues affecting it, whether it be floods and or hurricanes in a place like Florida or Texas, Louisiana, as you said, fires in California, and even hotter climate in parts of the country, and drought in places like Arizona. Well, here in Japan, we have, as everyone knows, a new prime minister as of Monday. Mr. Fumio Kishida took office on Monday, and the COP26 UN Climate Change Conference is taking place in just about 4 weeks in Glasgow, Scotland. And Mr. Kishida said at his opening press conference on Monday that he probably would not attend in person, but he does plan to participate online, perhaps in a Zoom meeting like the one that we're doing right now. So it's a new government with a lot of challenges, and one of them is to expand upon the pledge made by former Prime Minister Suga to have Japan go carbon neutral by 2050. And I think Mr. Kishida plans to uphold that pledge and continue it. So I guess my first question would be to Toyoda-san, with your long experience in government, what do you expect from the Kishida government in terms of climate and energy policy?
Yes, thank you for your question. I think among four candidates, Kishida-san is perhaps trying to follow what the Suga government has made. And our climate change with respect to 2050, Japan is trying to aim at the zero carbon energy system. I'm sure he would follow that roadmap. And in terms of policy, yes, I think the Japanese government, Suga government, try to characterize three important energy, zero carbon energy for main driver. One, renewable energy, solar or wind. Second, nuclear. In addition to that, as Fred-san said, the Japanese government is emphasizing the importance of hydrogen and ammonia. Blue or green, we don't care. It's quite important because two important energy, which I mentioned first, renewable energy, nuclear, are not perfect. They are important, but not perfect. We need the third abundant zero carbon energy, which could be hydrogen and ammonia. And I understand the Kishida government is following this policy, and now it's time for him to realize the policy. At this moment, still, you know, the sixth basic energy plan is not yet approved by the cabinet, but I'm sure Kishida government is trying to approve at the cabinet. And then it's time for him to his administration to realize that path. And I'm sure he would do that, although it is not easy.
Right. Right now, you know, one of the issues that's come up just in the last few weeks even is a power shortage in China. And We've seen power outages, factories having to shut down. And one reason seems to be the response to climate change adopted by the Chinese government. They've actually begun to discourage coal-fired power and tried to reduce the carbon emissions. And that seems to have perhaps led to an overreaction where some coal plants have shut down maybe prematurely or aren't operating profitably. And so it's affecting the lives of everyday people and also the economy through the industrial sector. And so one question I have, but maybe I'll start with Osano-san, is how can we prevent? Of course, we want to take action to prevent climate change and certainly prevent climate change from hurting people through all these factors such as natural disasters. On the other hand, sometimes the response to climate change can also have a big impact on daily lives. And what can we do? How do you see that the situation in China, and what can we do to avoid that kind of abrupt transition?
Thank you, Peter. It's such a timely topic that it's so shocking to read those blackouts in China and India. And I didn't expect that sudden change happen. We kind of trusted government or market might function more smoothly, planning the transition in more prepared way. But, this could happen. And it kind of showed us how important for us to have well-planned transition. And it's already that goal setting down, necessity shared among people, but the issue is how to make it happen. And abrupt yes or no, invest, divest, dichotomy doesn't help us to reach to the ideal situation. We need transition method. At the same time, we have to invest in the new innovation that could take like 10 years to be materialized. It's so complex, the climate change is, and that impact society, economy, also geopolitics, everything. So that's the reason I believe that's very careful planning and coordination among different specialists will be very, very important. And for a while, I don't think we can just shut down coal petrol-related power generation. It's encouraged to let them transition to less environmental impactful manners, methodology. Also, when we have enough supply of ammonia, like coal burning, we could reduce the environmental impact. So there are ways to reduce the environmental impact and while sustaining our social and economic activities, although the cost will go up. And then how we pay that cost will become a very real issue for us.
Now, Asan, how do you see these issues? Perhaps from a corporate perspective, a company like Denso that's trying to do business in a place like China, and all of a sudden, they say, well, there's no power, your factory has to shut down. How do you plan for these kinds of things and prepare for them?
Yeah, that's an important point. Rather than, as Amy says, rather than, making this kind of knee reactions to this kind of carbon neutral stuff or climate change stuff, we have to really be better prepared if it is in China, taking place this kind of, accident. We need to really multiply our sourcing supply chain. But at the same time, we keep talking about supply side of the game, but why not talking about demand side of the game as well? For example, carbon is very important for our body and for all the health of living life. So rather than talking about carbon zero, how can we really move on to, for example, circular economy by regenerating things many times rather than consuming things? So not only one-sided carbon neutral, I would rather like to combine this kind of climate change with circular economy so that people would stay more like minimalism type of life rather than just keep consuming. And when we talk about Japan used to be very much proud of this minimalism mindset, and especially in Edo era and all those ancient days. So consuming or consumer, the word consumer itself is a very dangerous word. So rather than talking about supply side or demand side, how can we really combine these two in this kind of circular way? So that's more important. When we talk about technology, something like artificial photosynthesis, for example, that would convert CO2, carbon, or CO2 into a kind of important stuff like something bioplastic, something like that. So why don't we really try to investigate into this kind of arena rather than minimizing carbon? How can we really utilize carbon into better kind of products? So we need to really have this kind of more integrated view of the issue rather than just keep looking down, this kind of carbon side of the game.
Fred, I know, you're in the US right now, and maybe Americans are a little more selfish about this kind of thing, but if you tell people that climate change policy means that you can't have something or you can't consume, a car or food, that people in the U.S. tend to react negatively, and I think it's a potential election issue, and our American politics are more polarized. But Fred, if I can turn to you, what can be done in terms of public opinion and shaping how people respond to these climate change efforts?
That's a big question. I guess the media has a role there.
Right.
I don't want to be a downer or a pessimist here, but I kind of look at what's going on around the world with the power outages in many countries and also fuel prices spiking as maybe the way things are going to be for the next several years, because we are embarking on a very difficult energy transition. And, for all talk of planning, which I agree is the greatest idea, years of reporting on things makes me think that the plans are bound to go awry and reality wins out. And there are going to be hiccups and glitches. So one thing that I wonder about, and I think your public opinion question is really spot on, that it's important for public opinion not to go against efforts to continue with climate carbon reduction or climate measures as prices go up, potentially, as power prices go up, as, these glitches happen. I think that they show the fragility of the power system and infrastructure now, the need to hurry and put in alternative energy sources. But already, you see again, back to public opinion, you see people trying to tug and pull on the narrative. For example, in China, I've been talking to a lot of people looking at the energy the power outages in China, and some, you know, there's some discussion of saying, what does this mean? You know, does this mean that China is going too fast, or that actually it needs more coal power for stability and baseloads? Whereas other people are saying, well, no, this shows that coal is dangerous for energy security. You can't rely on coal for energy security because of volatile market prices. And this just shows that when prices spike, it's not a secure fuel. So I think we have to be wary of and think through these kinds of discussions very carefully and try and see the, you know, all the angles and all the subtleties, and try not to fall into a narrative of, you know, well, it's climate change measures that are making our lives difficult, and continue on with those types of energy transition measures rather than be discouraged by them.
Right, it's easy for what they call in some people in Washington talk about demagoguing an issue. That means acting like a demagogue and making exaggerated claims about climate change and how it threatens your lifestyle. And that's always a risk because it is an issue that affects so many people, and people have a right to be worried and concerned about their own lives and how they'll change. Let me turn back to Toyoda-san for a moment and ask about how Japan can contribute to the world. Of course, Japan, nobody has it perfect, but in your position that's at the IEEJ and elsewhere, I know you've worked on technologies that could help help this transition happen in an orderly way. And I wonder if you could talk a little bit about where Japan's best contribution can come from. Toyoda-san, I think you may be muted at the moment.
Thank you for the question. I think, as I said already, Japanese policy trying to diversify zero carbon energy. Many countries try to focus on renewable energy and some nuclear, but we tend to say Both zero carbon energy are important, but not perfect. And I understand renewable energy is mostly intermittent, and so they have to have a backup. And nuclear, it is not only Japan who has a lot of concern with safety. And so we try to increase renewable energy as much as possible, and we try to keep nuclear as much as possible. But in addition to that, simply it is they are not sufficient. We try to emphasize the importance of decarbonization of hydrocarbon. I think that's why Japan is trying to emphasize blue hydrogen. Actually, we don't care. Both are fine. Blue hydrogen from fossil fuel, green hydrogen from renewable energy, both of them are fine. But for the moment, I think in the next maybe 20 or 30 years, blue hydrogen is more affordable than green hydrogen. And then why not? And I think one of the message which Japan is trying to send to the world is that hydrocarbon is not the enemy. Emission of CO2 is an enemy. And if we can deal with CO2 emission, hydrocarbon is fine. For instance, we are focusing on hydrogen production from gas because it's cheaper and it's easier.
That's blue hydrogen, is that right?
Yes, that's right. And but at the same time,
natural gas.
Right. At the same time, well, blue hydrogen, I'm sorry, the definition of blue hydrogen is hydrogen produced from hydrocarbons, so not only gas, but also oil and even coal with CCS technology. And simply because gas is easier, easiest hydrocarbon to produce zero-carbon hydrogen, and so most Japanese companies are focusing on gas for hydrogen. But some are trying to produce zero-carbon hydrogen from brown coal in Australia, and brown coal is cheap, and so we are wondering whether it is the most affordable hydrogen or not. We have to see. But the point of which Japanese government is trying to say that hydrogen is not the enemy. Emission is enemy. So we have to deal with the enemy. And if we can deal with CO2 emission in dealing with hydrocarbon, hydrocarbon can be a friend for us. One important thing, which Landa-san, you ask many people, many panelists about the China. The China is trying to promote or rather accelerate the energy transition. I appreciate that, but it should be gradual. It should be planned. I'm sure China is good at the planning energy transition, but this is the first time for all of us, and so it's not easy to make plan. But one thing which Japan is trying to do is co-burning of hydrogen or ammonia at coal-fired plant or a gas-fired plant. You may have noticed that the Japanese government is trying to say by 2030, 1% of zero-carbon hydrogen ammonia can be introduced, and only 1%, but it's huge, 3 million tons of, say, ammonia. And what they are trying to do is to co-burn this zero-carbon ammonia at the coal-fired plant. If you try to use existing coal-fired plant, you could mix 20% of zero-carbon hydrogen or ammonia. And if you can change the burner, you could increase the share of co-burning of zero-carbon hydrogen ammonia up to 60%. If it can be realized, 60% co-burning, and then it's much cleaner than ordinary gas-fired plant. And so I think the Japanese government is making a contribution by saying that hydrocarbon is not the enemy. The enemy is CO2 emission. If we can deal with CO2 emission, we can have more variety of energy. Hydrocarbon for us to achieve a zero carbon energy system. And so maybe China, they have more coal-fired plant in their country, and India, yes. And so if they can co-burn, they don't have to stop using coal-fired plant abruptly, and they can use co-burning process and they can phase out gradually, or even they can continue to utilize hydrocarbon. And so maybe this is Japan can share as a lesson, and probably the transition could be more smooth. That's Japanese contribution, perhaps. Thank you.
Thank you. Fred, you've visited some of these facilities where they're beginning to test out using hydrogen, and Toyoda-san talked about mm-hmm. you might have an existing coal-fired power plant that doesn't have to be scrapped and thrown out. So maybe you can use that very same plant, but mix in other cleaner sources such as hydrogen and ammonia. But it does sound to me, just hearing that, you know, it sounds very costly. It involves new sources of fuel from places like Australia. It involves new processes, shipping it to Japan. What was your sense, Fred, as you reported on this subject about how practical this is and whether this can be a real solution or at least part of the solution?
My sense is that it's a big bet. People are gambling that they can bring the price down of blue hydrogen to some place that's roughly competitive with coal. And however, I want to say a couple things about hydrogen, because I do think that it's one of the biggest interesting contributions Japan is making to a global discussion here. And that's it's for hydrogen. Hydrogen's been around for a long time, but it hasn't really gotten off the ground. It's expensive, as you point out. It's not an efficient way. It has a lot of inefficiencies in energy conversion. But Japan, with the coal burning plan and the plan to use it in power, if it works, has proposed a really interesting source of demand, and large scale demand, like a huge tonnage of ammonia that will be needed even for 20% co-fired coal burning. And if that can get off the ground, if the prices can come down, if the trading infrastructure and the shipping can be built, as you mentioned, Peter, then that could, I think, be a sea change for hydrogen that could actually help launch the market globally as well. On the practicality side, ammonia is a much more practical, I've been convinced, cost-wise step than pure hydrogen. So I think that one of the interesting things is there are a lot of companies, like everyone from Jeddah, the Japan's biggest utility, through the trading, the big trading companies, through the big power equipment, machinery makers, et cetera, that are involved in spending real money on trying to make this happen. And so I think, and they, you know, also point out that Japan did pioneer a system of trading and using LNG gas at a time when many people thought that that was going to be too expensive and too technologically difficult. So I would say it's not, it's a huge challenge, but there's a lot of serious government and corporate effort and money behind it.
Fred, just briefly for the students, both the young and old here, can you explain just briefly, what is ammonia and how could it get from, if we're talking about building a supply chain that maybe starts in a place like Australia, where does that supply chain start and where does it end?
Ammonia is nitrogen and hydrogen compound. So with quote unquote blue hydrogen, and I assume Toyoda-san, et cetera, will correct me if I'm make an error in what I'm saying here, but let's say you start with a fossil fuel like natural gas or coal. The first process involves a lot of energy and in some cases a lot of heat to produce the hydrogen. And the problem with hydrogen is that it's very difficult to carry around. It's an extremely, it takes a lot of space. So you have to compress it. If you liquefy it, it has to be liquefied at extreme temperatures, extremely cold temperatures, very close to absolute zero, close to the temperature of outer space. And that temperature obviously has to be maintained for however many miles, if you're shipping it, for however many miles you're shipping it over. So there are big technological challenges to moving around hydrogen. And since Japan doesn't have enough resources to make the amount of hydrogen it needs domestically, it is looking at sourcing the same way as it now sources a lot of fossil fuels in, say, Australia or the Middle East or the US. And rather than shipping the hydrogen to start out with, and this is, you know, I think it's a very practical plan, we'll start out by adding nitrogen to that hydrogen to make ammonia. And then that becomes much easier to ship. That the ammonia is shipped these days in tankers that already exist and move the stuff around. So let's say you've got a fertilizer plant in the US that makes hydrogen and ammonia already for fertilizer, and you take it now starts making more with carbon capture for power production. You would ship that on a tanker to Japan, and you know, in theory, they're building the infrastructure to carry that to a place like a utility like Jeddah, which can then use that in its coal plants.
It's so interesting to hear that description, and so many parts go into it, whether it be, as you said, creating the hydrogen, or then mixing it with nitrogen to create ammonia. Then it has to be shipped to Japan. Somebody in Japan obviously has to receive that. So it's not something that you can just make a technological breakthrough and immediately apply that to a large scale, you know, energy system in Japan. It requires so many other parts. And I think Nawa-san, you mentioned at the beginning that you when you were outside director at Denso, you had a car that rides on hydrogen, and that's great. It's a great car, the Mirai from Toyota. It's a great car, but it requires a network, an infrastructure of hydrogen fueling stations, which mm-hmm. doesn't really exist yet. So I wonder, you've heard us discuss hydrogen a little bit here and new energy sources. What's your perspective on these issues of Japan's contribution and new energy sources?
Yeah, I'm quite optimistic about this, actually. I saw the same kind of arguments some time ago about LNG, as you mentioned, and also when we talked about hybrid, which Toyota introduced toward the end of last century. Nobody really agreed that this would make sense, but it happened. So it's important not to just follow the kind of common sense which was argued among journalists and scientists. And I would also like to bet on this kind of Japanese spirit to try to make it happen against common sense of the Western world. So that's what I like to really, that's why I have been with Toyota side for a long time. And the more I hear the kind of common sense story from Western people, I feel there is a good chance for us to really try to, counter argue with the realities or practicalities, which we can prove in Japan to the world, as Toyota-san mentioned.
Interesting. So the common sense that you're talking about says, oh, that ammonia or hydrogen, it's too hard, it's too difficult, requires too much change, and give up because it's just not possible. That's the right sort of common sense in the West that you see right now. Have you heard that from colleagues or friends overseas?
Yeah, pretty much. I guess I have been talking to Chinese people every week. And they are, of course, not only trying to work on EV side of the game or electric vehicle side of the game, they are trying to bet on many other things. And I hear kind of monotheism here in Western world. And here in you know, Eastern world, we have this kind of rather, you know, kind of, how would you call it? Multi-thesis, right?
Polytheism, yes.
Polytheism. So we like to bet on many other things, and let us have a kind of liberty to try to prove it rather than try to convince us with your monotheistic, you know, kind of mindset.
So you're saying that people in China that you talk to also see a potential here for some of these technologies?
Yeah, hydrogen included, of course.
Interesting. You mentioned Toyota. Osono-san, I didn't include that in the introduction, I think, but you wrote a book, I think, about Toyota as, you know, one of the world's leading innovation companies. Correct me if I'm wrong, but you know, how can Japanese companies participate in this innovation and persuade the world that those who are skeptical and say it's hopeless, it's impossible? How can Japan say no, it's not impossible?
Well, you mentioned about this, not only producing hydrogen or ammonia, also need a supply chain and infrastructure that we need those people carry and receive. And I'm a member of a working group at the METI who, you know, help the private sector to proceed R&D and spending 2 trillion yen for the government money to support. And one of the areas like ammonia and hydrogen, and they see it, for example, ship, ocean fleet, but it will be just too small power. And so they need to change from oil to gas. And hopefully they start with LNG, natural gas, and then ammonia, and then maybe hydrogen. So switch from oil to gas is a huge leap. And they are trying to come up with engines, tanks, and supply chain. And they're not only focusing on technology side, but also trying to put the infrastructure, supply chain there. And they do that for 10 year time distance. So it's very long-term project for a government project. And you can see that how serious Japan is. And this is that the it's government money supporting, but also the private sector is spending equivalent amount of money, and that it's companies who is doing R&D and make trying to make this commercialized. And if we a few step back, Japan has the largest share of solar panel when we only consider the flat land. Although we have 70% of the national land are mountains. So it's very difficult to increase furthermore. Maybe that's a good, give us a good motivation to come up with innovation like solar panel you can bend put on your building surfaces. But also Japan has to diversify its energy source. And energy is such a core thing because unless you have a better energy mix, has less environmental impact, manufacturing industry cannot operate in Japan once the world introduces carbon pricing and everything. Or although the reporting will start pervading scope 3 supply chain environmental impact. So it's very, very important for Japan as a land for Japanese, also international companies to operate, to have better energy mix that has less environmental impact. So there's a strong motivation to diversify the energy source. And I see that they are very, very serious about this.
Right. You mentioned the government has this 2 trillion yen fund and nearly 20 billion US dollars to invest in new energy innovation. As you said, the time horizon is so long. And you know, in Silicon Valley, somebody, some college student can come up with an app to deliver food to people's houses. And maybe they spend a month programming this app, they get it in the app store, and pretty soon, you know, everybody's using it, and you're a billionaire within a year, thanks to your new innovation. But in this area, it really requires, as you said, a decade or two decades. But you want that entrepreneurial spirit. You want not just large companies and not just the government involved. You want young people and innovators involved. How do you strike that balance?
Right. But there are some areas that the deep tech, so-called, that you need to spend time and money to make progress. And it's good to have the large established corporations as well as government serious about this. But at the same time, the government learned from past mistakes of government-led projects. So they are trying to be more open to startups internationally, try to connect with the users, like Takashi just mentioned about the importance of creating demand, so that not only achieving the technological breakthrough, but those technology will be used by the users. So the way they manage those big projects are becoming a lot more improved when compared with the past decade Japanese government driven projects.
Right. Maybe I'll stick with you, Osana-san, for one more question and then go around the rest of the panel as well. You know, all of you have lived outside of Japan and inside Japan for a very long time, including Fred. I'm sure there used to be a program about 20 years ago on TBS, I think it was called Koko ga Hendai o Nihonjin. You know, you Japanese, featuring foreigners in Japan who would say what is heng or strange or bad really about about Japan based. And I think a lot of foreigners would say, well, in my country, we do it this way. Why don't Japanese people do the same thing? And I think probably when Japanese people go overseas, they may see the same thing. Like, we have this wonderful way of solving this problem in Japan. How come you guys, you know, here in China or US or Europe or South America, how come you guys haven't discovered this wonderful Japanese method yet? So I wonder from your experience and, you know, bicultural experience, whether you have lessons for Japanese people and also lessons for the world about how to look at these climate issues. And again, I'll start with you, Osana-san, if I may.
Well, that's tough. Maybe what I want to see more in Japan and learn from outside of Japan is having more direct dialogue with the next generation, more official, more straightforward way. I believe that Japanese younger generations are voicing. They have strong wills, but we have a very well organized or official way to listen to them. Having them on board might not be that pervasive here, not yet. We listen in more a casual, unofficial way through a network, but may not be like, we don't have next generation on the board of a company. I don't know, everybody agrees that we're not, everybody have different expectation on what the board should do. But just as an example, you know, thank you.
That's interesting. So you're saying, you know, if a board of a company, and all companies are dealing with climate change, including ones that you, I believe, have worked with and or serve on the board, if the board is all people 60, 70, 80, they may be missing a perspective, just like we look for gender diversity or diversity of background, that some age diversity may help them get a better grasp of the problems that people are seeing.
Yeah. So company aware, so they kind of develop new channels to talk with NGOs, younger generations, but not yet on a official decision making system.
Right. I'll go back to you, Toyoda-san, and ask the same question. You know, what when you you know, meet international leaders, is there anything that you wish to bring back to Japan, and again, vice versa, the other way around?
Well, yes, we can learn from each other. I think, Randall-san, you said this is strange, this is hendai-o, but I would say this is different. I think it's important for us to recognize the difference. For instance, in Europe, we had been working together with a German counterpart or a UK counterpart, but they emphasized that the importance of wind power. But in Japan, we don't have much wind power, even though we try to find and try to let them generate power. It's far away from Tokyo, Hokkaido, Akita, or Nagasaki. But clearly, we are trying to develop. But we can say the same thing with respect to ASEAN. They have quite a lot of sunshine. But compared with the Middle East, they have a lot of rainy days or rainy weather. And they have very much limited wind power. And so the countries are different in terms of energy endowment, and that matters quite a lot. And so probably European countries can have a larger share of renewable energy, because they have a lot of not only solar power but also wind power. But here in Asia, particularly Eastern Asia, Korea, Japan, Taiwan, and ASEAN, we have more considerable sunshine, but not necessarily wind power. And so there is a limitation in terms of expanding the share of renewable energy. And some countries can, but I think Japan and Korea are trying to stick to nuclear, but not many countries can introduce nuclear. And then what they are also trying to say that can we decarbonize hydrocarbon? I think that's one thing and quite important. We have been working with our German counterpart for 5 years, and 3 years ago, they started having an interest in hydrogen. And now, perhaps as a government, Germany or UK, they are promoting hydrogen quite a lot. I think UK tried to have interest in blue hydrogen as well, in addition to green hydrogen, but Germany, they are sticking to green hydrogen. That is fine, because they have a lot of renewable energy, but we don't. And so the important thing is that we are not strange, we are different. We have to understand, and we can learn from each other. And I think now Saudi Arabia is trying to say they can export both blue hydrogen and green hydrogen. And they are producing green hydrogen at NEOM, and perhaps they can do that. And so I think we should recognize the difference, and we can learn from these differences. And so we can work together, but we can recognize the difference. That's quite important. And one thing which I would like to add about hydrogen and ammonia, I agree with Nawa-san's point. We could be that optimistic, and particularly with respect to ammonia, I think Fredson said the shipping is easy. Freezing temperature is 50 minus 50 plus 50 degree or something like that. It's a ordinary ship. Ammonia ship is here and there, and we can continue to utilize the existing technology. But hydrogen is difficult because freezing temperature is 252 or 250. Three or four, and so they have to develop new technology. But already Kawasaki Heavy Industry has developed, and they are trying to introduce the first demonstrated hydrogen ship this year. We don't have to be pessimistic with respect to ammonia. Perhaps. We can introduce in mid-2020s, around 2025. It's toxic, and so again, the infrastructure, we have to improve infrastructure, and simply it is toxic, and professional people can deal with that, and so power company, perhaps only power company can utilize that, but the power market is huge, and so ammonia can be coming first much sooner than hydrogen, but hydrogen is coming probably 2030s, and I think we can be optimistic, and everything can be coming from different energy endowment. But we can learn from each other from on the basis of differences.
Right. Thank you. Nawa-san, how are you? Is there anything that makes you frustrated or when you see the global debate about climate change, or to put it in more optimistic or friendly terms, you know, are there differences that we can learn from in Japan and the rest of the world?
Right. I cannot agree more with Toyota-san that, you know, we are talking about differences. And also, we are talking about inclusiveness here. Rather than, you know, having just a de jure type of mindset from Europe, we like to have more multiple options here, rather than, you know, trying to make it as a one standard, which we are hearing from Europe. Or from US, we are hearing something like, de facto standard. Again, standard, right? Winner takes all. Here in Japan or here in East Asia, we do not accept that sort of only one thing would play the game, right? So rather than, you know, betting on one kind of common sense, why don't we try to explore several avenues? And again, Japan has proven this in the past, like fuel cell LED lights or green plastics. And it's coming soon, something like, ultra thin lightweight solar panel, which Amy was talking about, coming very soon. And also optical semiconductor, which can reduce the consumption of energy of all those, kind of digital power into 0.1%. All those things are coming soon. So again, I'm very much optimistic on this kind of technology, capability, but we have to also open up from Japan's side to make it more inclusive. That's why, the reason why people try to skip, a hybrid, for example, is that only Japanese companies can make. So rather than make it that way, why don't we really open it up to the rest of the world, so that they can also try to, learn from us? Of course, we have to learn from US and from Europe, but we have to be proud of ourselves and we have to be different. Unless we have this kind of diversity and try to, Western people try to force Western way of thinking, that's very much one-sided, and the evolution of the human culture would not really happen in that sort of one-sided way of life.
Fred, I'll turn it to you. We have some excellent questions from the audience. So Fred, if you can add your thoughts to this discussion, and then we'll turn to some of our audience questions.
Sure, I'll be brief. I think looking at the energy issue, and reporting in a bunch of different countries. What Japan, I think, could learn from other countries is be a bit more ambitious and aggressive and less cautious. Caution is good. Pilot projects are good. But I think, and you know, this is government and big business and media tend to get comfortable and to think, well, we can't really go faster than this. But then somebody like Biden, President Biden, or former Prime Minister Suga come around and say, well, you know, we have to do this. You know, we have to reduce emissions by double what we had promised. You know, Japan will find a way off as other countries do. And I think that more ambition, I guess, more less need for gaiatsu, pressure from outside, and more, I guess, ambitious speed inside Japan would be good on the energy issues. And what other countries can learn from Japan, especially from the US perspective, I think, you know, there's so much more sense of communal responsibility in Japan, whereas in the US, trying to do anything immediately runs up against, I know panelists have mentioned it earlier, issues of personal individual freedoms and rights and the personal want to consume various things. So it's a lot easier, it seems to me a lot easier because of that feeling that, you know, more of a feeling in Japan that there is, people are responsible for others in the community, and that there should be a sense of communal responsibility. It's a lot easier to implement some of the painful things, or anything from energy savings to consumption reductions, to make the difficult choices in Japan than often is in a country like the US.
Right, sense of community. Well, here's a question from, thanks to many people who submitted questions. I may not have time for all of them, but try to get to as many as we can. This is one from Jimmy, who is in the MBA, Hitotsubashi ICS MBA class of 2010, he says. And he says he has a question about Toyota Motors' reaction to electric vehicles, both for Professor Osono and Professor Nawa. He says, from what he sees, Toyota Motors' reaction to EV is something like, well, since we're falling behind, let's try to convince the Japanese government to postpone the carbon neutral event agenda to give us some more time. That gets to Fred's point about, you know, how urgent, how quickly are we moving? So Jimmy asks, do you think Toyota Motor is making a big mistake, or is this the right way to catch up in the fast growing EV market?
Let me answer that question.
Okay, go ahead. And then yes, we'll get to also on that. Yes.
Okay, yes. Again, you know, as Amy says, we're talking about deep tech rather than, you know, just a digital world. And we need to have this kind of continuous effort to really, you know, make it happen. And that's the beauty of Japanese culture, you know, Kaizen and Gemba stuff. And, you know, again, Western people, they will talk about speed and skill and ambition, all those things, which can easily go into war type of situation, right? Rather than that, we like to really make it happen in a continuous way. And it's a kind of, you know, we'll see this in next 10 years and 20 years. In what is the kind of just just talk, and what is the reality? And Toyota is very known reality rather than just talk, like journalists or like scholars.
How do you see it, Osono-san?
Yes. Well, let me tell you that Toyota is very, very serious about electric vehicle, battery-based electric vehicle, very serious. But they said they are not trying to be the first company, but they want to be the best company to provide the, to solve the environmental issue. And electric vehicle and battery-based is one of the solutions they consider. And there's also many issues with the current electric battery-based BEV. But they've been very much seriously working on to improve the battery itself so that they can, that there are so many different performance like speed, duration, safety, cost, and they're trying to solve those trade-offs so that the new generation battery will make their customers happy at the same time, less environmentally impacting. So again, like Toyota-san said, that they say the similar thing like internal combustion engine is not the enemy. The enemy is environmental impact negative. So for them, that's the ultimate goal. And they are trying to try many different paths to solve that issue. And they position EVP as one of them and really, really serious.
Thank you. Let me move on to another question from Melody in our audience. She says, many businesses in Japan have started to add sustainability pages to their websites, or they advertise what they are doing in terms of SDG goals. But many consumers, says Melody, see this as just something for PR, or sometimes it's called greenwashing. You sort of tout your environmental credentials without actually doing anything. So she asks, how do you think businesses in Japan should balance this and work to actually make an impact? I guess, Osano-san, I'll go to you again, then we'll go to the others for that answer.
Thank you. How Japanese company can be more serious, what they should do to make impact? I think some of them, it's very dangerous to generalize Japanese companies as one group. Some of them are very, very serious and identify materialities that where they can make true impact, and spending money, monitoring their impact and reporting those initiatives very diligent way. Some of them are still like checking the laundry list or, you know, SDG 17 boxes. And you can tell the difference. And I think it's all depend on how the company leadership position this issue with their unique the purpose, that's Takashi's pitch, and also their strengths, uniqueness in a competition and a market. So there are two different types, I'd say. And some of them are very, very good. Some of them are not, maybe, yet.
Right. Please go ahead, Nao-san.
Yes. Talking about the good side of those two parties, you know, which Amy was talking about, you know, Toyota included, they are really trying to make things happen with innovation. Innovation is the key, right? Greenwashing, all those talks are just being nice to the society, right? But not only one-sided view, we have to really think about multiple sources in terms of supply side, in terms of demand side as well. It's very complicated, and there are several other many avenues to go. But innovation is the key here. Technology is one, and also cultural innovation or demand side of the innovation is another. And rather than talking all those SDG 17 cars, we have to really do serious how to innovate. Supply side and demand side. And a good part of Japanese companies are working on it rather than just, greenwashing. Not only Japanese companies, but many Western companies are just greenwashing on SDGs and ESGs. So I'm kind of counting on those good part of Japanese companies, again, Sony included, Hitachi included, all those companies, and some of the startup companies, likewise in Western companies from, Generation Z and Generation Alpha, people are betting on this innovation, and that's the key rather than just talk.
Thank you. I'll direct this next question to Mr. Toyoda. I hope I'm pronouncing our audience member's name correctly. Selden asks, he said he was nice enough to read one of Fred's articles about hydrogen, and he says that according to that article, Japan's energy roadmap is moving towards reduction of conventional energy and more renewable energy. So he asks, how is Japan's energy mix going to look like, from a base load, intermediate, and peak load perspective? That's one question. And then he asks also about hydrogen. We've had a lot of discussion today about hydrogen. He asks, is there a risk that the hydrogen society will be a Galapagos society? And I think by that he means, is there a risk that Japan will pursue hydrogen, but it won't get the buy-in, the support, and the cooperation of the rest of the world? And maybe hydrogen is a great idea, but is there a risk that it will fail because Japan doesn't have cooperation and support from the rest of the world? So those are the two questions, one about Japan's energy mix and the second about hydrogen society and the Galapagos society.
Thank you very much for the question. With respect to energy mix, the sixth basic energy plan is saying that about 36 or 38% of power is coming from renewable energy, and 20 or 22% is from nuclear, and the rest is fossil fuel. But still, by realizing that, we could reduce CO2 emission, GHG emission by 46%. If you calculate CO2 intensity and compare with Europe or with the United States, I think Japan is the least carbon intensity by realizing that. Yes, it's not easy, particularly as I think Osono-san said, we don't have a lot of flat land. And so by 2030, we have only 9 years, and maybe we cannot increase the share of wind power because environmental assessment takes 5 years, 6 years. And so probably the government is trying to promote solar PV, although the flat land is not quite a lot. But I think it's possible. And with respect to nuclear, again, it is not easy. We have to reoperate the 27 reactors, but only 10 reactors are in operation. And so somehow we have to learn how to optimize safety regulation from US or from the UK, from France, and try to speed it up. But I'm not pessimistic because 10 reactors were deoperated over the last 5 or 6 years. So perhaps 20 more is not impossible. And clearly, nuclear is regarded to be baseload energy. And fossil fuel, particularly coal-fired plant, we reduce quite a lot. But still, by co-burning with ammonia, we could reduce CO2, and then it could be a sort of base load as well. And with respect to hydrogen, yes, I think the challenge is the cost, how much we could reduce the cost, how speedily. And R&D is important, and the government is providing 20 billion US dollar fund for R&D. But I think, as I said at the beginning, the Japanese government spend more expenditure for infrastructure. I think that is quite important. It is not only for EV, but also FCB, and also infrastructure for ammonia, et cetera, et cetera. And compared with the amount of expenditure for infrastructure in the United States or in Europe, I think Japanese expenditure is quite limited. But I hope the next Kishida government is trying to increase. And with respect to the cost reduction, another important thing is enlarging the market. If it is only Japanese market, the cost down is limited. And so Japan is trying to work together with first Asian countries, including China, ASEAN, India, and also we are working closely with Asia Pacific, Australia, Mexico, and the United States and Canada. So by doing that, we could expand the market for hydrogen and ammonia. With respect to the United States, you are very lucky because you have a lot of gas and you have a lot of spaces for CCS. And you don't have to transport by ship. You could utilize the existing pipeline for transportation. And so you could introduce hydrogen much easier than Japan. But the point is we have to work together among many countries. We are also working with European countries and learn from each other on the basis of the differences. Thank you.
Thank you. We have a question from Kitty in the ICS class of 2021. So she's part of that younger generation that we just heard, you know, is whose voices are so important in getting sort of society-wide consensus on measures to address climate change. And she asks as follows. She says it takes time and money to deal with this challenge. She agrees with Professor Emmy that especially the next generation matters. And she says, I believe young people today do care about the situation. So she appreciates if some of the guests could offer advice on how to get more prepared to participate in this process. So maybe I'll ask the two professors on that question. Professor Lozano first, how can young people get more prepared to participate in these changes ahead?
Oh, wow. Try to see, take multiple perspectives. There are so many things not known yet. Even the data is still, there's so many different standards to count the impact. Also like the how the favorable we can be about hydrogen, depend on who said that, the conclusion is very different, you know. So like Elon Musk calls the hydrogen as a fuel because of the energy inefficiency creating hydrogen. So there are many different perspectives, and I warn young generation to try to see the things from different multiple perspectives and wait, and also try to go to the reliable source and check the data. And we're starting to receive more and more data. And measuring is the first step for to make progress. We should know where we are. And that we're starting to see more of like carbon pricing or all those ratings of the companies and financial sectors working very hard to make more reliable, comparable reportings. So take different perspectives and also go to the data and see the reliability of data with critical eyes. That's my message. Thank you.
How about you, Professor Nawa?
Yes, I'd like to quote what Steve Jobs likes to say, which is, don't go to where the puck is. You have to really follow. You have to find a wide space where the puck will be. And rather than just following the common sense or the kind of common denominator, why don't you try to find out white space, which are wide open and the finance is there to invest in you? So you as a young generation, try to find the open space rather than just follow the suits.
That's great advice. Thank you. Mm-hmm. We probably have time for just one more question. And sorry if I didn't get to everyone, but one person asks, I think implied in some of the discussion, especially that Toyoda-san was making about hydrogen, ammonia, and some other using carbon and fossil fuels rather than just rejecting them outright. I think some of the background to that was the idea of CCS, carbon capture and sequestration. So somehow putting the carbon deep in the ground so it can't do any damage. This questioner says the panelists speak about the utilization of methods to sequester carbon or reduce CO2 emissions as the best methods towards attaining more sustainable energy sources. But he says, don't the panelists feel that, or it could be a she, I should say, he or she asks, don't the panelists feel the process of obtaining the hydrocarbons or fossil fuels themselves is polluting in itself? When you dig out all that oil or natural gas from the ground, isn't that also polluting? Wouldn't it be better to move towards sustainably sourced fuels that aren't as polluting in terms of emissions? Toyoda-san, you want to grab that one?
Well, I thank you very much for the question. I think we have to look at the fact. We have to look at the evidence. And by using CCS technology, the modern one, the most efficient one, 90% of CO2 can be taken out. And so I think a lot of discussion is going on with respect to CCS, but I think the most important thing is let us look at the fact, let us look at the evidence, of scientific evidence. I think that's quite important. And probably at the Hitotsubashi University, most students have a mind of researching on the basic, on the basis of evidence and facts. And so that is quite important exercise for us, all of us.
Thank you very much. I think we'll have to stop it there. It's been a very stimulating discussion, and I wish I could summarize in a word lessons, but I did make just a couple of quick notes to summarize some of the interesting thoughts we've had today. Nao-san talked about polytheism, multiple gods, not just monotheism, one god, and looking for a variety of solutions and considering the differences among countries as we look for solutions to the carbon challenge. Different solutions in different countries, but also working together, as Toyoda-san said, is important. And Japan not just turning into a Galapagos on its own, but working with many countries to bring some of these supply chains and addressing these global challenges together. Fred talked about the need for speed and feeling a sense of urgency. That was in one of the questions I didn't get to, but the one questioner did point out that we can't just let this sit slowly. There is a need to address the problem quickly if the scientists are correct about the impacts of global warming. And looking at, we heard just now about looking at the facts and the evidence. And maybe I'll put in a brief plug. Hitotsubashi is a great place to learn about facts and evidence. And also if you're looking for a website, I hope students will consider Wall Street Journal and other news sites to keep in touch with energy and climate change news. And I think maybe the one final message was that there is reason for optimism. Yes, it's obviously serious issues, and we see the challenges even when there are power outages and so on, but there's also reason for optimism in the kinds of new technologies that Japan especially is bringing to the fore. So thank you to all the audience for joining tonight. Thank you to our panelists, each of you, for your stimulating thoughts. And thank you again for the questions. And I'll close it there. Good night.
Good night. Thank you.